Years. So as you can see from the title, this is a long, work of a long, scope, covering five decades. I can see that many of us here, if you already burned your, small site, but I can also see some of you here as a contemporary of Professor MacFarlane. Professor MacFarlane is an anthropologist and historian who taught at the Department of Social Anthropology at Cambridge University for 34 years. He is now Professor Emeritus of Anthropological Science and a Life Fellow of King's College at Cambridge, besides being a Fellow of the British Academy and the Royal Historical Society. He is the author of 20 books and numerous articles, including Resources and Population, A Study of Gurus of Nepal, published in 1976, and another book, Gurus of Nepal, A Guide to Gurus, in 1990. Professor MacFarlane has done research on English society of 14th to 19th century, the Gurus of Central Nepal, and the Nagas of Burma, India border. He has also done research in Japan and is presently working on various research and cultural communications between the West and China, for which he has already made 40 visits to China. I understand that he is leaving to China from Nepal, and I also remember that when I had opportunity to visit him in Cambridge, he was working on the production of the visual materials on teaching anthropology. So with this introduction, I'd like to welcome Professor MacFarlane and for the delivery of his lectures.
Sitting down. They may prefer not to see me, but I'm afraid I'm going to stand up anyway. Well, thank you very much, Dr. Tamang, Lama Tamang, for your kind introduction, and thank you very much for the organizers who have invited me today, and to Tech Guru, who has been behind the arrangements for this occasion. It feels rather strange to give this talk because I've been coming to Nepal now for 50 years. Better and better. Coming to Nepal for 50 years, and this is the first time I've talked to an academic group like yourselves in those 50 years. I once, well, a few years ago, I talked to Navajo Bookshop to a few academics, but this is the first of these kind of occasions. And so it's very appropriate that I should be doing this in my 75th year after coming here again and again and again. This will be quite a personal account, which seems suitable for such an occasion. What I want to do, since not all of you will be anthropologists or even social scientists, is to explain what I think an anthropologist does and why Nepal has been so important for my wife, Sarah, and I. It all started, in fact, 75 years ago, not 50 years ago, when I was born in Shillong, in Assam, on the border of Burma and India, Assam. And I was brought up for my first 5 years in Assam, moving to a tea plantation where my father was the tea manager. And this set the seed, I think. I think I was probably nursed. I had an ayah who was a hill woman, probably Garo or Khasi. And this probably imprinted it on me, the idea that all good things came from hill women. So I have always found people with oriental features particularly attractive, and I have for a long time wanted to come back. So when I had finished my degree in history and a doctorate in history, I went to the London School of Economics and retrained as an anthropologist and decided to try to come back to see the world I had known as a child. And when I tried to arrange this, I went to my supervisor, who was the first Western anthropologist to come to Nepal in 1953. This is Professor Christoph von Führer-Heimendorf. I was his last student. And he tried to get me to Nagaland and failed to do so because of the Naga resistance movement. So I said, well, what shall I do? And he said, oh, well, go to Nepal. Beautiful place, I've been there many times. So I said, well, where is it? And he took out a map and said, well, it's there, between India and Tibet. So I said, okay, where in Nepal? And he said, well, why don't you go to the Gurus? He said, I met a young man a few years ago called Bernard Pinyeg, and I suggested he worked on the Gurus, and he wrote a very good book in French on the Gurus, but he died, and so there is much left to do there. So I said, fine, where shall I go? And he said, well, go to Siklis, which is quite a big Guru village in the Annapurna Mountains. So my previous wife and I set out. It arrived in December 1968, so it's more or less 50 years. And I did field work there for 15 months, and got my PhD and wrote a book on resources and population, and then left. Well, I left to write these. And I meant to go back quickly, but I remarried Sarah and we had young children. So it wasn't until 15 years later, 1986, that we came back. I expected that they would have forgotten us completely. But of course, when we arrived in the village, everyone said, oh, where have you been? Why didn't you come back sooner? So we decided, particularly my wife who loved it, that we would come back. So we went back in 1987, 1988, 1990, 91, 92, 93, 94, 95, and so on. Almost every year until the Maoist insurgency of 2003, and then about four times since. So this is our 21st visit. And throughout that time we took censuses, films, diaries, because I was interested in long-term change, and particularly ecological and demographic change. And therefore you needed to keep going back and taking censuses and genealogies. And this experience has completely changed our lives. And I want to now turn to the ways in which this has shaped us. I want to do this under four headings. The first is the first purpose of anthropology, really, is to discover the other, to go out of your own civilization and try and go as deep as you can into another world, a mental world, a moral world, an economic world. So to discover the other has always been the aim of social anthropology, to expand your experience by doing that. The second heading is to discover deep laws or tendencies about human nature and human societies. Sadly, nowadays, anthropology has become so professionalized and so much work has been done that most young anthropologists take a very, very, very small subject and often seem, or at least not they, but their supervisors, have forgotten what really the aim of anthropology is, which is to give some insights on a much broader scale. My teachers, who were of the great generation of structural functionalists, people like Edmund Leach and Maya Fortes and Jack Goody and Heinendorf himself, we're interested in the really big questions. What is it to be human? Are we all alike or different? What are the basic drives and so on? And so I was attracted to anthropology because really I was looking for patterns and a meaning to life. I had lost my religious convictions around this time to a large extent, and anthropology for me was really a religion. It's been commented, for example, by the great French anthropologist Lévi-Strauss, that most people who are professional thinkers do a certain subject. You do history, you do literature, you do philosophy. But there are three subjects in which you don't just do something, you are something. They are vocations, they're like religious callings. And Lévi-Strauss said that the three vocations were music, mathematics, and anthropology. You don't just do mathematics, you are a musician, and you are a musician. So I was searching for something like that. The third reason is to discover something about ourselves. We must not forget that you don't just go out to discover the other. Ultimately, you are discovering more about yourself. Anthropology is a wonderful mirror. because it shows all the distortions of your own culture, your own civilization, and your own personality. So it is a wonderful work, a way to discover the deep weaknesses and minor strengths that we have. And finally, I have always been interested in methodology, and so a lot of my work in both history and anthropology has been trying to discover new ways of communicating through film, through computers, through databases, through writing, experimental anthropology of that kind. So, under those headings, let me start with what I have learned from visiting Nepal so many times. And particularly what I have learned about living in a village in Nepal over those years with my wife Sarah. The first shock, I suppose, really, when I came to this village in 1968 was the shock of discovering what most of human beings, through most of human history, have had to endure in the way of making a living. This was a particularly difficult place because how many of you have been to the Annapurna Mountains? Here, on the Annapurna Trail or up to the, quite a few of you. Well, you all know Nepal and you all know the terraced rice cultivation on the steep mountain sides of Nepal. Well, the shock of coming to a place where there was no electricity, there was no source of power, there were really no use of animals except for ploughing and manure and meat. You didn't use animals much for transport. So all the work, 90% of the work, on hillsides which are terribly steep, steeper than the steepest mountains in the UK, for example, all this has to be done on the back, with the arms, with the head, with the legs. And they're doing this day after day after day, because obviously as anthropologists we tried to cut the rice and beat the, what is called in Gurung, the Puni Domba, the rice pounding machine. And just doing this for a few minutes, or trying to lift off the ground the kinds of bundles of rice or vegetation that they carried, particularly women carried, made us aware of the terrible strain, exhausting work of living in all societies until about 200 years ago. Living in a pre-wheel culture was a real shock and a real revelation, and helped me a great deal in understanding something about the history of my own civilization in Europe. I learnt to admire the immense skill and the immense hard work of ordinary people day in, day out, and particularly of women, as I mentioned, who have the double burden, bringing up their children, looking after the household, but also doing a lot of the agricultural work, particularly among the Burons, where the men are away often in the army or in other kinds of employment. The second shock, really, I suppose, was discovering a world before the state. Now, even when I first went to the Burun people, if they talked about Nepal, they meant the Kathmandu Valley. They didn't mean their village. Their village was not in Nepal, their village was in Kaski or whatever. So, and there was no presence of the state. Obviously there were no policemen, no government officials. They kept away from that, very low taxation. So basically, they lived in a world where they ran their own social order and their political order informally, through informal pressures of family, kinship, neighborhood, and a certain amount of class stratification. So I could see how societies worked before the state emerged. And in some ways, of course, this is not just a Gurung village, but it is the whole of Nepal. Nepal is a miracle because for about the last 20 years it has not had a government, basically. On and off, little bits of government here and there, but most Nepalis work without much intervention of the state. So I learnt about such a world. The third thing I learnt, which is a deeper lesson, is about what the modern world is and its opposite. You don't understand your own world when you are embedded in it until you see the opposite. My world, as a child, as I grew up through English education and English social structure, taught me that I was an individual. The individual came first, the group came second. It taught me that I had to begin to separate as I grew as a child into a young person, into a young man. I had to separate off my religious life from my political life, from my social life, from my economic life. So I should split myself into four parts. Religion was for certain areas, but not to be mixed up with politics. Economics was not to be mixed up with religion, and so on. Now, this was a difficult lesson to learn because a child mixes all these things up. And much of English, Western American society, mainly the what is called the Anglosphere, which is the British, including American area, lives in this separated world, described in the title of David Riesman's book, famous book, The Lonely Crowd. You are ultimately lonely because you are alone in this world where you have split your life. This is a disenchanted world because religion is pushed into a box. This is the effect of the Protestant Reformation and disenchantment, as Max Weber, the sociologist, described it, is the feature of our life. It has its good sides, the greatness of English poetry. Most of our great poets, from Milton to Wordsworth to Yeats, write about this. This is why we have the greatest poetry in the world. Also our children's story writers, the greatest children's story writers, 90% of them are British, including Scottish. And this is because they're writing about an enchanted world which they have lost, from Alice in Wonderland up to Harry Potter, is about this disenchantment, an enchanted world contrasted with a grown-up, adult, rational world. But living in a Gurung village and seeing their world, they didn't separate. If, for example, you gave someone some food, if someone came to your house and you gave them a cup of tea or some rice, you weren't just giving food. You were giving a social relationship, an economic relationship, expressing political matters. And probably, if you're having a meal, you take a little bit of the rice, you sprinkle it into the fire, because God lived in the fire. So it was a meal was a religious activity, an economic activity, a political activity, and a social activity. It's been much described by anthropologists, particularly Marcel Mauss in his famous book, The Gift. Gifts have spiritual levels. So everything was mixed together. And this is a great pleasure and joy. For example, my friend and former student, Tech, here, when we come and visit him, it's not just a transactional relationship. It's a family relationship, it's a political relationship, it's a spiritual relationship. All these things together. So to live, go back into the magical world of my childhood, in a sense, in this kind of village, was a wonderful experience. And the last element of this was that, I don't know how many of you know much about the gurungs, but the gurungs are unique in the whole of the Himalayas. I work in China now quite a bit, and I looked at a number of the Himalayan ethnic minority groups there, and I looked across Nepal at Magars, Tamangs, and so on. The gurungs, I think, unless until someone tells me or proves to me the opposite, are unique in having the best recorded religious tradition of an oral culture anywhere in the whole of the Himalayas, which must mean that they have one of the best in the whole world. This is because when in their great migrations down from northern China, down through the Gansu corridor, Sichuan, across Tibet, down through Mustang to where they are now, they preserved, they have shamanic priests who preserved in their spoken texts and their rituals ancient traditions and rituals going back more than 2,000 years, telling of the origin of the world and the movement of these peoples. And these survived and were very alive when I went to the village. I had a teacher who was, they are called Pochu, who is sometimes called Jankri in Nepali. And I had a teacher who was the Pochu, and he explained to me all these different texts. And so what I entered into, and I filmed, and I have a big film record of all this, much of it disappeared. My films are perhaps the only films surviving of a lot of this. A lot of them are on YouTube and also on the streaming media service of Cambridge University. It is a big collection. This preserved a world which, again, I half knew of as a child, but had forgotten. Shamanism, as you know, is based on a kind of animism. It's based on the idea that we don't live in a world which is just a material, dead environment. We live in a world where everything has spirit in it. We find it in many different cultures, in the Amazon, obviously in Japan, with Shinto, and to a good extent in China with Taoism. So basically, everything, if you go to the forest and you accidentally damage a certain kind of tree, then the spirit will be angry with you. And so all of life is lived in a world with spiritual meanings. And the people who can see this spiritual world are the shamans, the pachu. And if you are ill, they will find out. For example, when I went completely deaf in this year, 17 years ago, I went to the National Health Service in Britain, and they were, of course, useless and couldn't do anything about it. So I went to the local shaman in Tark, and he did various rituals on me, for which I had to give him a chicken. So I gave him a small chicken to kill and do the ritual. Anyway, it didn't work. So I came back the next year and I said, I'm afraid your treatment didn't work very well. And he said, well, you gave me a very small chicken. So anyway, it was amazing to enter into this shamanic world. And also helped me enormously, because when I went on from Nepal to work extensively in Japan, and I've written a book called Japan Through the Looking Glass, which is about, obviously, alluding to Alice through the Looking Glass. And I discovered, I think, the key to Japanese civilization, which no one else had discovered, which is that it's a shamanic society. It's based on ancient shamanic Shinto beliefs, and the surface of Japan, which is very modern, is just a cover. Deep down, it's very similar to a Gurung village. No one could have seen this unless they'd been through the experience of going to a shamanic society. Then, turning to the next heading, what I discovered about how the world works. Just a few very, very simple lessons. The first is a famous phrase in anthropology, which is the psychic unity of mankind. The psychic unity of mankind refers to the fact that anthropology is based on the assumption that all human beings, wherever they are basically at a deep psychological level the same. Otherwise, anthropology would be pointless and impossible. If you have different species, as it were, living, different species of human beings, then there would be no possibility of communicating with them. It would be like trying to communicate with an ape or a dolphin or something like this. So anthropology is based on this paradox, contradiction. On the one hand, it's interested in differences and are very aware of huge differences. On the other hand, it's based on the idea that all human beings, men, women, children, all colors and races, have at a deep level a lot of similarity. That there are very few differences in native intelligence, native morality, and so on. And I found this, when I came to Nepal, I sort of half expected, I suppose, from my historical training, which suggested that people in the past were very different from people in the present. I suppose I half expected to find very difficult to relate to people in a simple mountain village. In fact, it wasn't. As many anthropologists have recounted, you become very close to people. The young man who was the son of the shaman, Prem Bahadur, who was my chief informant and friend, he became one of my closest friends in my life. I didn't see him very often afterwards, but during that time, we were very, very close, and I enjoyed his company enormously. And I found, since that, I was adopted into a Gurung family. I had a father, mother, sisters, and so on. And I found no difficulty at all in feeling that these people were very, very like me, and I was like them. In particular, later on, when we came back, I started to work closely with a Gurung woman called Dilmaya Gurung. And Dilmaya was about 10, 12 years younger than me. And I was her adopted brother. I'd been adopted by her stepfather, and so I was her brother. And here was a woman who was completely, in every way, the opposite of me. She never had education. She'd never really been out of the village. She was a woman who'd had children and I hadn't. She had none of the books or computers or any of these things. And she was believed in witchcraft and all these things. So basically, it would seem that it would be very difficult for us to become close. And yet we did, and I've written a whole book about her, which I hope to make available soon, because it's the only book ever written which is about a person in an oral culture, a woman, with all the films I took of her. because I started to film her life and interview her. So all this is linked to the book. So you can actually see her talking, see her doing things, and then there's the book as well. So when she died suddenly, in the tragic way that many women in this society die young with heart overwork and strain on her heart, the age of 42, it was a loss greater than almost anyone in my experience. Perhaps only two, perhaps only my mother, and to a certain extent my father, were of equal magnitude in my feelings at her loss. So this is illustrating the psychic unity. Another thing I learned was that anthropology is an art and not a science. What I mean by this is that in my book on the Goodwins, I did my best to try and analyze all the economic and demographic statistics. And I made various predictions on the basis of this about what would happen to the village in the next 20 years or so. And they all turned out to be completely wrong. I had sort of thought that anthropology was a kind of, like other sciences, you could make some laws and predictions. My prediction was that the place would become heavily overpopulated, destroy the forest, there would be ecological destruction. What, of course, I could not foresee was the growth of all sorts of things outside the village, particularly the growth of the world economy, and particularly the growth of Pokhara and Kathmandu. Because it's true that the village population did expand and double, as I predicted, but they didn't double in the village, they all went out of the village. So the village population actually shrunk, and when I went back 15 years later, there was more forest than when I left. So this is just a reminder to all of us that the social sciences are not predictive in any way. There is actually a simple philosophical law which is worth knowing about, devised or explained by the philosopher Karl Popper. We cannot know about the future because we cannot know what we will then No, in other words, the growth of knowledge, which is occurring all the time, is unpredictable. So I have found again and again in our visits, it's been a surprise. If you had told me 20 years ago, halfway through this period, that I would go back to the village as we did 2 days ago, and find everyone sitting cooking on gas stoves, not everyone, but certainly where our household, that they had three lights, that you would drive up to the village in a jeep, that everyone would spend the whole evening on smartphones. Hardly a word was exchanged, but they were just talking to people all over the world. All this has happened in the last 10 years and was quite unpredictable. Even the smartphone revolution, which is one of the biggest that has occurred in the last 8 years. I could not have predicted this 20 years ago. So what will happen in the future, I don't know. The third and last thing I want to mention about what I discovered about how the world works, though there have been many other things, is to do with the strength of culture. Now, when I came, it's difficult, you're all so young, it's difficult for you to imagine the kind of intellectual framework I brought in 1968. This was the great heyday of Marxism. And so I'd been at the LSE in 1966, 67, during the great riots and the Paris uprisings and the events in America. And we were all very left-wing, many Marxists, and Marxism was the framework which had come into anthropology and sociology and so on. Also, the other framework was called modernization theory. And modernization theory, which was American, suggested, like Marx, that societies go through stages. You have stage A, stage B, stage C. You have tribal, you have peasant, or you have hunter-gatherer, tribal, peasant, modern. Or you have ancient societies, feudal societies, capitalist societies, socialist societies. So we go along through stages, and this is what I believed when I came. This meant that each time you made one of these big changes, the whole system would change, and you'd start again. Well, this is what I thought would happen, and when I looked at the 50 years that has occurred with the people I've worked with, the pattern has been that much on the surface, everything on the surface has changed. The economy, the living in the villages, and so on. But the gurums themselves have not changed. They, after this long migration, 2,000 years down to the gurum village I saw, changing into rice cultivators, they then went down into Bukhara or Hong Kong or London. And when I meet them in these places and spend time, I suddenly see they are the same people. They will have a little ancestor shrine in the corner of the room. They will eat their rice with their hands. They will talk to their children in the same gentle, kind way that they do in the village. So even if they haven't kept their guru, and there are many here who are from parts of Nepal where gurus who don't speak gurum, language is not the thing that is keeping the culture of the gurus together, which is interesting. You could lose your gurum language but remain a guru. There is something about the pattern of the social structure, particularly the child rearing system, which means that gurum culture is very, very tough. And this is very encouraging. I found the same thing in my historical studies, that English civilization and culture on the surface is constantly changing. But at a deep level, if you look at England, you find that many of the things that were there 1,000 years ago are still there. The legal system, the language, the humour, the family system, many aspects of the religion are very similar over 1,000 years, and it's the same in Japan, and it's the same in China. China has just shown another example of this recently, in that it has an imperial system, as you know. So, from the first emperor, the Qing emperor, it has been run with an emperor at the top. And they keep trying to get rid of this, or people come in and kill the emperor and start anew. But then they just get sucked into the same pattern, Manchus and Mongols. And of course, when they try to eradicate it most strongly recently, Chairman Mao became the new emperor. And then they thought they'd got rid of Chairman Mao and the imperial system. And as we know, this week, Xi Jinping has more or less pronounced himself the new emperor. He's made it clear that he's not leaving and not named any successor. So basically, this pattern of the Chinese culture, which is like this ship, is maintained. And I found the same shape has persisted with the gurus. So I've seen it on the micro scale as well as on the macro historical scale. The next thing I would like to talk about is what I've learned about myself. You have before you one of the last representatives and most extreme examples of an imperial British Tsar. My family have been going around the world, ruling the world for the last 200 years, going to Burma, the first lawyer in Upper Burma was my great-grandfather. My grandfather drew the border between China and Burma. They were consuls at Hanoi. They were translators on the Second Opium War. They were the first white child born in Jamaica, all over the world. Imperial British is in my blood from all my ancestors. My education was reinforcing this. I went to schools which still had not quite realized after the war that the empire was over. It takes time to adjust. So the British public school system is, of course, a training for imperial officers. So the prefect system and so on taught me how to lead Gurkha regiments or be a district officer or whatever I was going to be, but it was too late. So I became an anthropologist instead. Anyway, I came with all this stuff in my head. And my first field work was just beginning to shift. I was beginning to realize that this was no longer the case, but I still had some of my white, superior, Western baggage with me. And what has happened over the last 50 years, I hope, is that you never can get rid of this. It comes out in hidden moments. But as much as I can, I hope, I have just forgotten that. It's irrelevant. I don't now, for instance, go into a Gurung village or anywhere else saying that I know better about anything, that I know how they should run their lives or start this project or whatever. If you know anything about the history of anthropology, the earliest anthropologists, people who came from my university, Cambridge, like Rivers and Haddon, they did kind of scientific anthropology. They went to a place, they took films, photographs, and took genealogies, and then they went away. The great revolution in anthropology was supposedly caused by Malinowski and others who got off the veranda, they got out of the house on the veranda and just talking to people who had been summoned to talk to them. And they went and put up a tent in the village square. But even Malinowski and my generation and my teachers, many of them very famous, were still at some distance. This isn't true of all of them. My supervisor, Fiona Hamidorf, whose diaries I have translated or have had translated, it's clear that he had the same deep experience as I did. His best ever friend was another boy. But you have to go down and down and leave that whole imperial background if you're going to be an anthropologist today. The other side of this was that we were taught that anthropology is a kind of objective science. I was taught at the London School of Economics by Malinowski's successor, Raymond Firth, and others, that basically what we as social scientists do is to study the other. So the other, it's a kind of experiment. You go out, you find an undocumented society or one about which you want to know something, and then you study them. You take censuses, you take genealogies, you do interviews and so on. But you try to remain objective. Anthropology, as you know, is often defined in its method as participant observation. And in that balance, the observation was much more important than the participation. What I learned over my time in working here and elsewhere, is that the participation is more important than the observation. We observe anyway, we all observe, and you should be observing, you should be noting, but it's participating that is really the most important. Anthropology, of course, is nothing more than ordinary behavior. Any human being, it has to be a participant observer. Any child, the moment they're born, is a participant observer. They do what their parents tell them to a certain extent and participate in family life and so on. But all the time they're watching, thinking, watching themselves, watching the other, watching the relationship. And anthropology is just a refined version of that. But gradually I stopped thinking of myself as a scientist studying the other and began to feel myself as part of that other world. Another thing I learnt was that in some ways I'm still very much a historian as much as an anthropologist. I found my first field work very difficult. I was, like everyone is, I was a bit ill. My wife was more ill than me. I was lonely. I didn't know a word of the language when I arrived. So it took some months before I could communicate. And I found the disordered life of an anthropologist, which is that you can't guarantee any work getting done. As a historian, I could go to a library, or I could go to an archive. At the end of the day, I lost some notes, and I was moving forward. But when you go to a village, and you arrange for someone to come see you, they don't come. Or when they come, whatever they tell you is useless. So I was quite worried, anxious about what I was, and I was very, very homesick. I love England, and I was very happy there. And so when I went back, I became a historian again in Cambridge for four years. Then I got a job in anthropology. And so my life is both. It's impossible for me to say that I'm a historian or an anthropologist. But I do know that I am very aware that the weakness of anthropology, some anthropology, is that it assumes that the past is not very important. Malinowski himself, for example, made the unsatisfactory leap from, say, we can't know anything much about the past because these are oral cultures, to then assuming we don't care anyway. The past influences the present, whether it's oral or literate, and therefore much of my work has been historical in the fact that I've had the unique opportunity of working for 50 years in one community. It means that the account can be quite historical. The next thing I learned was the desire to share my experience. One of the very frustrating things about anthropology is that you go to a new place, you go through this huge emotional turmoil. Anthropology has been defined, for example, as life being a musical instrument on which the culture plays. So you were like a violin or a trombone or something, and the culture plays on you. Now this shakes your whole personality, your assumptions, everything. And you see this whole world unfolding, all the cultural and social dimensions of it. The dancing, the music, the aesthetics, the smells, and everything. And then, having had this wonderful, amazing experience, like being on a super holiday, you then go back to your own culture. And how can you convey what you've been through? Because the conventional method is to go back and write a thesis or a book. And I often think of this is like going and seeing a wonderful river flowing along with shimmering and fish and so on. And then you go back to your culture, take out all the water. All you've got is the dry riverbed of the facts. So unless you are an extremely good writer, and anyway, that probably wouldn't be acceptable for your PhD, you can't convey even the methods, for instance, suggested by Clifford Geertz of thick description. If you try thick description for too long, your audience turns off. You know, if you start describing a ritual detail by detail, very soon a reader can't follow it or find it interesting. So my solution to this, to a large extent, was using film. Sarah did all the hard work, which was the census work and genealogies and so on. And I took a lot of film, because just in 1 minute of film, you can often convey a lot of the emotion and the excitement of another culture, which is very difficult to do in words. On the other hand, you need the words too, because you can't convey any theoretical ideas with film unless you're a very good filmmaker. So my life has been, or my work on the Golems has been, trying to devise methods of books with films attached, or the other way around, films with books attached, and I've made 5 of these. And the last thing that I would like to talk about is a little more about the methodology. On the whole, anthropologists don't like talking about any methodology, probably sensibly, because they really don't have one. When I went to do field work, I just went. No one. There were no training. There's still, the training is totally unsatisfactory because you can't train one. Because people go to such different situations and you can't anticipate beyond a few very simple things about ethics or taking a census and so on. Very difficult to train someone because anthropology is about the whole of your personality in relation to a culture, and you can't train that or teach that. On the other hand, there are some things which you can write about and think about, but anthropologists on the whole have not pursued this. So I've always been very interested in how you gather data, collect materials, because this will affect what you do. And just one tip for any of you who are in the process of becoming anthropologists or thinking of it. One thing that Sarah particularly does, and I do a little, is to carry a little notebook like this. This is Chinese, but it can be Nepali. I think the first ones I bought were in Nepal. And it's got to be small enough so it can fit in your hand. And basically, why it's so important that it's very small is that you have it with you all the time. And the moment you start talking or observing, you can just have this like this. When you're talking to someone, you can say, I'm just going to note a few things down as we go along. All you note in that is the main points of what you're talking about. Talked about his wife's death, talked about his visit to Brunei, talked about. And if you do that, and any quotations or facts need to be remembered, and then at the end of the day, this is what Sarah is wonderful at, the end of the day you transfer that into, well now of course onto a laptop, but in our case into a paper diary. And if you have this, you can remember the structure of the day. If you don't, it's all blurred. So that's one kind of methodology. The second is data storage. Anthropologists never think much about how they're going to refine all that material. In fact, there's no account in any anthropological book about the most important part of fieldwork, which is after you come back from the field. The second fieldwork. Because fieldwork is in 2 stages. You go and you observe and you collect and you think, And then you come back and you reanalyze, you relive the experience. It's very similar to poetry. One of the great descriptions of poetry by Wordsworth is emotion recollected in tranquility. That is a description of writing up fieldwork. You've had the emotions, you've collected the data, you've let time pass, and then you reimagine that world and make sense of it in your writing. And the writing is an active process. Most people mistakenly think that anthropology is like archaeology, where you collect things and then you analyze them and you come back. In anthropology, the writing is the anthropology. This is why there was a big interest in the 1990s in writing culture, Clifford Geertz's work and so on. You discover the society through writing about it and discover yourself. And so the whole craft of anthropology is largely, you won't find textbooks about it. The thing that is holding up my microphone here, or loudspeaker system, is a book which I'll extract after I've finished using it underneath here. Is a book on fieldwork and how you do it, which has got a description of all these things I've been talking about, plus films, about 75 films of how I, Stover, actually did our fieldwork. It's all very well to write, well, we went out and collected a census, or we then went out and tried to cut rice or something. If you actually can see the film of that process, then it's different. So, to conclude, the experience of spending about 3 years, I suppose, in a Gurung village, away from all the familiar things of our, in our lives, has been, as Sarah and I often say, perhaps the most important emotional experience of our lives since we married. The West is lovely, and we enjoy the hot baths and the food and the friendship, but we always feel when we go back from Nepal as if we are going back into a world where we are surrounded by cotton wool. We don't see the green, the trees, the sky, and things so clearly. We can't just walk into someone's house and have a cup of tea. We have to ring them up and make an arrangement. So the emotional warmth and kindness of the people of Nepal has made our lives much richer. And just to end on that, often when I talked in the past about our good fortune in coming to Nepal and particularly to the Gurung people, I used to say, well, the Gurungs, everything, they represent everything good that I know in human beings. They're kind, they're honest, they've got a wonderful sense of humour, they're very hardworking, they're very loyal, everything. Perfect. There's only one thing that is not good about them. That is that there are too few of them. There are only 500,000, 600,000. So I used to make this joke. Now I can end the joke by saying that when I started to work in the homeland of the Gurungs, which is China, I discovered the wonderful thing, which is that there are 1.4 billion Gurungs, and they're called Chinese. because the same qualities. I've taught many Chinese students, and I have many Chinese friends. And they have these same qualities which I, my wife, greatly admired. So it's been an honor and a privilege to come to this country. And thank you very much indeed for listening to me. That's the book, Fieldwork with the Gurungs. Okay? Not quite available yet. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor McFarlane, for it was very interesting and insightful your reflections on Gurung Society, and also reflection on the changes we did yourself. Well, this is really great opportunity for us to kind of reflect on the change over the last 8 years. You have very beautifully woven what anthropology is and also what it means to be an anthropologist, and introducing the arts and crafts of anthropology. This is really, you have really wonderfully laid out the context for discussion of what, you know, the change. One thing I would add is that now we have got some of really prominent guru anthropologists as well. So I'm sure there are a lot of questions and comments from the floor. So we shall open the floor, and if you could kindly introduce yourself and put your question and comments, that would be good. So,
if you could also, if you want to speak in Nepali, it can be translated, but if you could speak very loudly, because I'm deaf, okay?
Professor McFarlane, you said that some things have changed and some things have not changed. Now, what I would like to specifically ask you is 50 years ago in Gurung village, I think most of the Gurung boys would like to have get recruited and get a job with the British Gurkhas or Indian Gurkhas. But I imagine now they don't have that kind of dream anymore. Would you like to comment on that, or do they still want to serve in the British Gurkhas or Indian Gurkhas and leave the village, or because of the modernization and the avenues of communication, improvement in communication, there are other avenues open to them. I mean, do they still have that feeling? I would like to know your comment on that.
Thank you very much. Yes, when I went in 1969, there were probably 7 or 8 serving Gurkhas in the British Gurkhas and the Indian Gurkhas. 15 years later, there might have been 1 or 2. And it's probably been 20 years since anyone went to either the British or the Indian Army, maybe one. So they don't even really think about it. I'm sure if you asked one of them, you know, would you like a job in the British or Indian Gurkhas, they would say, yes, of course, it would be wonderful. But it's not really within their horizons. So this is obviously largely because the recruitment levels, in particularly in the British Gurkhas, have gone down hugely. So that avenue closed up. And another effect of that was that when I was first there, the Gurkha soldiers came back to the village with their money and their pensions, and they put it into buildings and into the local economy. 15 years later, they'd already moved down to Pokhara and were no longer doing that. So this has been a huge change. The Gurungs, or the people in the village now, mainly go to the Middle East, Saudi Arabia, Malaysia also, and do very, very tiring, difficult, awful jobs, very badly paid, awful hours. But these are mainly Dalits, not Gurungs. The Gurungs who have any money will try to educate them. They will take them down to Pokhara and they're going to school. And what they will do in the future, I'm not sure, because they're being trained for basically for office kinds of jobs or commercial jobs. So their future will depend very much on how the Nepalese economy does over the next 10 or 20 years. It may be very successful, in which case they will get good jobs. Otherwise, they will face the problem of young people all over the world that there are not enough reasonable jobs. Okay? Yes, please.
Yeah, thank you, Professor Alan Mekhaba. I'm Devin from CIKIS. Thank you very much for your nice presentation regarding to the groups. My question is related to the migration of the groups recently from Nepal to the UK, because there's lots of migration, you know, of the groups after the retirement, or even some of them have been recruited in the UK. So, I mean, when people shift, move from one place to another place, or from the temporal differences, then definitely there is a changes, I think, in sort of the social or cultural practices and belief. But one of your warnings was that usually people, they do not change it, they try to keep it, their culture or their belief or their practices. But looking into the social, economic, or the environmental aspect in England or UK, I think it is very likely that after some generations, the belief, the practice of the groups in UK will be changed. It is mainly, the other type is that, as you said, the number is very small. They are dominated by other people here. So their practices will, my assumption, will change. And so what is your assumption? You know, will they keep on for the next several generation, or their culture in England will die?
Okay, more questions?
Maybe we take some more questions and then ask for responding to the questions.
Yes. I was curious, based upon the extension of the second question, the gurus who live throughout their lives in Nepal, the gurus who go to Britain, become British Gurkhas or whatever they become, immigrants in Imperial Britain, and Imperial British people, who is the richer, and the richest of the three group in your view? Who is gaining, who is losing? Just curious. Thank you.
Can you repeat again, please?
Okay. Repeat again. Extension to the second question, I'm curious, based upon your experience and your view, if you had to classify rich, richer, and the richest, the gurus who spend all their life in Nepal, the gurus who become British Gurkhas or immigrants in Western world, and the imperial British or Americans, who is in the hierarchy of richness? Who is at the top and who is at the bottom? Just curious from your standpoint based upon your personal life experience. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, the first question was about the migration to the UK. Well, I can't remember what I put down, the migration to the UK, but what the question was, I'm not quite sure. But anyway, it's obvious you're interested in this pattern of migration. I think it was to do with how much of the culture is preserved when you move into different social and economic conditions. This is very puzzling because gurus are a sort of in between. If you think of migration, you get certain groups which have a very, very strong cultural tradition. Most famously, some of the Islamic migrants who keep their religion, their women keep their costumes, the women often don't learn language and so on. And so they preserve their culture absolutely and they form a kind of ghetto within the society they move to. There are other groups who move and are very easily assimilated and disappear entirely. Some European groups moving to America very quickly disappear. The gurus seem to be halfway between these. They don't disappear. If you go to Burnt Oak in North London, or certain parts of New York, or certain parts of Hong Kong, you will find guru communities. They have their own food, they marry with each other, they have their own child rearing system. Yet, of course, they also conform. They go to the schools, they get local jobs, so they fit very well. I think early on I decided that one of the strongest characteristics of the gurus was their flexibility. To have come from being fishermen hunters on the banks of the Qinghai Lake 3,000 years ago, then moving down through China, then becoming shepherds in Tibet, then coming down into the high forests of Kola of Siklis and becoming swin cultivators, and then coming down and becoming rice cultivators, then moving into Pokhara. They did this because they are enormously adaptable. There is very little hierarchy. Men and women are equal. There's no real class system. They are flexible. This is why they were recruited into the British Gurkhas. The first report on Gurkha recruitment said the wonderful thing about the gurus, apart from their strength and good humour, is that they will eat anything, do anything. They are very, very susceptible to change and change in organisations. So I think the gurus, the question I suppose ended with, will the next generation who have been brought up in UK or Hong Kong, will they remain gurus? What I seem to see is that they will. When we go to gatherings of gurus, I haven't been for a little while, and you see the young gurus with their parents and so on, they seem, on the whole, although they may have different smart clothes on and be listening to iPads and things, they seem, in their social relations with their elders and parents and other gurus, to be just the same. We had this experience actually in the last 2 days, because we've been staying in Pokhara, and a young man who's been in America for a long time married an American girl, and he came back with his children. And he himself certainly, you know, behaved in exactly the way that a young guru person would behave. I have to admit that his children were perhaps not as guru as, and they were half guru. Anyway, so I am optimistic, as it were, that a lot of the pattern of guru culture will prevail through the generations for a very long time. The second question about richness, of course, the first thing you have to decide is what is richness. If you're talking about economic affluence, on superficially, then the richest are the imperial Westerners, the next are the Gurkha soldiers and so on, the next are the ones who stay here. But it's not as simple as that. Firstly, even in terms of economic affluence, There is a very famous article by the American anthropologist Marshall Sahlins called The Original Affluent Society. And in that he says that if you judge affluence not by the amount of income you have, but the ratio between your income and your expenditure, in other words, if you, many Americans earn a huge amount of money, they spend even more. So they're always worrying about money, and they don't feel rich because they need even more and more and more and more. And in many simpler societies, your wants, your desires are limited, and your income is reasonable. So when we first went to, I first went to a rural village, I would say that the people were very rich, or reasonably rich, because what they needed was enough rice, enough buffalo meat, enough to pay for festivals and rituals. And they had that and a little over. So they felt rich, even if they didn't have much money. And then, of course, if you expand it from economic wealth to psychological, cultural, social wealth, then if you could measure happiness, which is another way of measuring richness, if you could measure, if you could put a happiness thing into people's mouths, I'm sure Bill Gates and his friends are already developing an app for happiness, which you can just pick up your cell phone and type in, how happy am I, and it tells you everything. When we have these things, and you take it to a Gurung village, certainly in the past, give it to someone and measure it, their happiness was far greater, or greater, than many of my friends in UK, who are anxious, worried, lonely, and so on. So money, as we all know, doesn't bring happiness. Too much money is as bad as too little money. So if you just got the right level, and you are internally content, and your social relations are good, then the wonderful thing of a Gurung village, which my wife and I observe, which is that it has meaning. You get up in the morning and you know what you have to do is to go and collect some buffalo fodder. When you've done that, you've contributed to the family and to your children's welfare. So life has a meaning. It has a pattern of the seasons and the meaning. For many people living in Western industrial societies, there is no meaning. There is no God. They have had a divorce. Their children are awful. They lost their job. Meaningless. So I think the people I meet here, looking at all your happy faces, I can see you are much happier than the audience in UK.
Professor, you are a key person, and I've read your book. I think you wrote with your mother, Empire of Tea. You've said the Gurungs came from China 2,000-3,000 years ago during the migration to Nepal. Would they have encountered tea? I'm a tea person myself also, so would they have encountered tea? And is there something in their oral tradition that refers to tea or tea plants? Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm, as you know, very interested in tea, and I've just been to Yunnan to see the original place where the first tea was domesticated. And I'm starting a big project on the history of tea and its influence. Tea was taken to Tibet in 7th century AD, and then very widely drunk throughout Tibet. And it's questionable when the Gurungs left and came through, Tibet, if they came through after the 7th century, and even as traders going up to Tibet, they would have encountered tea. They wouldn't have encountered it from the south, because the Indians didn't drink tea until the 20th century. And Assamese tea was only starting to be exported to Nepal in the 1880s. So tea is not very old. So the, on the whole, tea doesn't play much part. It's not in the myths or rituals, and there are not many records of it. So I suspect that for a long time the gurus may have drunk a little tea, but it wasn't important. Even when I went to the Guru village, often you would be offered water or hot water rather than tea. So I think tea is surprisingly rather a late import into Guru culture.
Yes.
Someone right at the back.
You mentioned that anthropology can be a mirror to see one's own society as well as oneself. But on the other side of that mirror, there are the people who you are studying. So my question is, what is the impact you leave on them? Is it positive?
I'm afraid the conversation might hear it and the distance between us.
I repeat very loudly, okay. So you mentioned that anthropology can be a mirror to see oneself and one's own society, but there are other people on that side, on the other side of the mirror that you are studying. And I want to know the impact that you leave on those people, and is it positive?
Yes, that's a good question. When I first went, as part of this objective view of the other, and that I was doing a scientific experiment, part of the idea was that these were very important old societies which you were studying and documenting, and you shouldn't interfere with them or change them. So I remember feeling quite guilty, because the moment I arrived, of course, my wife and I were changing. We changed the value of the chickens in the village, for example, by eating lots of chickens. We changed the value of firewood by buying firewood. We changed the even the music. I used to play guitar, and so I used to sing sort of American folk songs and so on, and they started to sing these as well. And we brought in lots of plastic containers and tins and so on. And all these things I felt rather guilty, because I shouldn't be changing the place. Later on, as I relaxed, I realized that we weren't the only people who were going to change them. There were tourists, there were travelers, hikers. And people had to learn, or at least be allowed to decide for themselves whether they want to change or adopt things. And it's rather patronizing and anyway impossible just to say, I'm going to come here, but I'm not going to change anything. So later on, I developed the feeling that some anthropologists felt that even giving gifts to people in the villages was changing things and was altering social relations. But very soon I just treated people as if they were my friends and family and so on. And if they needed something and I could help, then I would help. And even if it changed some aspect of the society, I didn't worry about it. But you're right. I mean, the extreme cases were awful. For example, in South America, when Westerners came in and gave South American tribal people terrible diseases and so on. And luckily, anthropology is not missionizing. Many of the early anthropologists were missionaries, and they were often good anthropologists, but if I had been trying to change the belief systems by preaching the gospel, whatever gospel, then I would now be rather ashamed of that, because I don't think you should go in and try and change that. But on the whole, we had a slight influence on them, and now I don't worry too much about it. Okay?
Yes, please.
My name is Bunsen Oren. Thank you very much. My name is Manfred Oren. I have one small question regarding to the actually the roots of the gurus. I remember in the let me say 80s or 90s, there was a news flash here in the paper which said that in actual fact, I think it was an American anthropologist who was claiming that the gurus came actually, or they stem from the Eskimos. And this was a very great news, and it was for a certain period, it was again and again in the papers. Have you heard of this theory? Because, I mean, this would be, you know, like even more northern than China. I mean, Alaska would be more northern than China.
Thank you very much. These stories of origin, of course, are fascinating. I expect there are people who think that the gurus came from Mars or another planet. But in a way, the theory has some truth in it. Not that the gurus came from the Eskimos, but that both Eskimos and gurus have a common origin. That is to say, Mongolia and North Siberia is where many peoples flowed from that area. The gurus, you could argue that the gurus came from South America, the South American tribes. They look like them. Some of their material culture has some overlap. And that's because the South American Indians, of course, come from Mongolia. They went across various straits and then down through America. So wherever you have Mongolian type people, they are probably from an area to the north of China and Siberia. So I think there is some truth in that. And it may be, I don't know enough about Eskimo culture, there may be elements of the ritual system, the drumming and shamanism, I'm not sure. On the other hand, Eskimos have an entirely different family system. They're famous for having a family system which is basically the one I have. The British-American family system, technically, in anthropology, is called Copper Eskimo. Our way of classifying our family, our kinship terminology, our descent system, is the same as a subgroup of the Eskimo. The Gurus, on the other hand, have what's known as an agnatic or male patrilineal system of descent through males. And so the family systems are totally different. So the split, whenever it occurred, was a very, very long time ago, and their social structures have changed. What I'm glad you're saying, or suggesting, and other people as well, is that there is no doubt in my mind that the gurus came from somewhere else a long time ago. There are theories that the gurus originated where they are now. There is at least one famous guru anthropologist who has this view. And it seems to me to be completely stupid, because firstly, there is the long guru myth ritual called the Sherpa, which describes their movements. Secondly, they incorporate a great deal of earlier systems, like Tibetan Bon religion suggests they've come from Tibet. And thirdly, if you look at the ethnic minorities of the Himalayas, I've worked on the Nagas, and I've looked at Southwest China, all the groups, none of the groups started where they are now. You know, the Miao moved from here to there, all the different groups have shifted. This has been a mosaic of moving ethnic minorities for thousands of years. And the idea that the gurus alone should have started in the middle of a forest on the Annapurna, slopes of the Annapurna, and stayed there ever since. Seems to me very strange and implausible.
Okay, if looks like they're not. Okay. This is the last question.
Hello. Hi, I'm Ansuguru. And whenever I introduce myself, my surname, they always ask me which guru you are. So I always say that I'm just a guru. And they said, you are not a guru. And I don't want to argue. And I said, okay, I'm not a guru. And you see in my Facebook page or somewhere, I dropped that, my survey. You know, so have you encountered this kind of situation in this village or no? Like there is a stratified, you know, 4 caste guru and 16 caste guru. Even in Hong Kong also, they do a kind of gathering. You know, when they celebrate Losar also, the 4 caste gurus celebrate, separately. They separate themselves. So do you, have you ever encountered? Because I have, all the time, almost all the time, they ask me which guru I come, like, I'm from.
Thank you very much. I didn't catch what your name is.
Ansu.
Alku.
Ansu. Ansu Guru.
Ansu. Ansu Guru. Well, that's a perfectly good guru name. As good as any other. If people say that to you, you say, well, there are many different groups of gurus and I'm one of them. And if they persist, you say, well, what kind of guru are you? And you could say, well, that's just a marginal guru. So don't give in. Don't just say, I'm not a guru. Of course, there is a lot of writing about the fact that, interestingly, among the gurus, there are these two groups. The Swami or Pligi and the Kuki, the 4 group and the 9 group. They used to be called the Sajat and Sorajat, but no longer use those words. What is really interesting about that is also in relation to this migration story, because when I first went to the village, this differentiation was quite strong in the work of Meshesmit in another guru village and so on, and Pinye suggests that these, in a way, these are people who call themselves guru, but they seem to be very different and have come from a different origin and then joined together. And this has then led to a huge amount of speculation about whether the 3 or 4 group have come slightly lower down and further from the east. They came further down China and then across and joined up when the other group came down from Tibet. The shamanic priests come from the 9 group, Kuki, and so they seem to preserve much more of a certain kind of shamanic civilization. When they came together, for some reason or other, maybe the 4 group had come earlier and had the best lands, so there was an economic inequality, and also there were some rules which led to a kind of very, very weak caste system. You shouldn't marry between these groups. You shouldn't eat as a 4 group. You shouldn't eat cooked rice from the others. This has more or less gone away. But there, for a while, there was a lot of tension about this. But then there are other anomalies about the gurus. For example, someone coming from eastern Nepal who doesn't speak any gurung. Or there are other groups who seem the Lamme seem more akin to some of the Tibetans. And so the gurus are really like the people I studied in on the Burma-Assam border, the Nagas. The Nagas now are all called Nagas, but they have within them many subgroups: Aonaga, Angami Naga, Konyak Naga, who speak entirely different languages and are clearly from different places. They've all come down, ended up in what is a bounded area. And I think this is probably what happened with the gurus. In that area, several groups came down, mixed together. And there's another group called the Gale, who live in Galegan and so on. They are sort of different from the Lagos. So it's a very mixed up situation. The one thing is, if you believe you are a guru, you are a guru. Okay?
Okay. We have two more questions. I think we'll end with this question, please.
Hello. Officer, my question is about indigenous nationality. Are Gurung indigenous or they are migrated from other countries? And this is one question. Other question is, there are two types of Gurungs, as we know. That is very much debatable, and it has broken our, say, Gurungness, in a sense. But there is one type of Guru who has neither four types nor, say, otherwise. They are nearby India and Nepal's border. They have only single caste, Lami Chani. Other caste, subcaste, they don't know. What's your subcaste? We are Lami Chani. And they get married in between them. I don't know how do they get married. And that's the grooms are also there. But there has not been the work yet upon such groups. What do you think it is?
Maybe we check the last one as well, and then we'll stop the session. Can you? All right.
Hello. And sir, thank you so much for loving me, Bob. You said like you have been here for 21st visit to Nepal. And 50 years is a big, it's a huge, huge fan. No, thank you so much for loving Nepal. And as you said your lecture, that it was very important and emotional experience in Nepal. I think there were difficulties too while adopting into culture. So would you like to share what were the difficulties? Because there are many people who would like to work with groom community as well.
Yes. Difficult.
I will consult my wife. The first question, I missed the first part of it, but the second part, which was about Lam Chani, and I know nothing about it, and I'm very surprised, because the whole point about, well, one of the main features of the gurus in the areas I've worked in is that you can't marry into your subgroup. So if you're a Kwanme, you can't marry another Kwanme. You have to marry a Lame or whatever. And likewise with the nine group. If you're a Yogche, Mobje, you can't marry another Mobje, and so on. So to find a group that says you can all marry within the Lam Chani, what you would probably find, I haven't studied it, but you would probably find that it's broken into sub groups of the Lama Chane, which have differentiated names. So you have the Eastern Lama Chane and the Western Lama Chane or whatever. And so you can marry an Eastern, but you can't marry your own. So I suspect they have ways of getting around it. But it again illustrates what I said in the previous answer, which is the gurus are very, very differentiated and have come from different places at different times. And really, to talk about the gurus is quite misleading. Same thing happens in China. There are now 55 accepted ethnic minorities, but within each of them, there are hundreds of varieties who, until the government decided they were whatever it was, Yi, Miao, whatever, they thought of themselves as entirely different. So outsiders have called themselves, have named them as the gurus. And it's quite possible that 200 years ago, the gurus didn't really think of themselves as the gurus. They thought of themselves as subgroups. Okay? I think the last question was about integration, as relayed by my wife, the difficulties of it and the negative aspects. I mentioned the negative aspects of coming and living in a Gurung village personally, because I was sick and lonely and all these things. I didn't find many negative aspects from the society or the people themselves. Obviously, a problem that many Gurung or people who work in other cultures have is that they come as rich foreigners, and therefore they create expectations, and therefore you may be kind to someone or get friendly with someone, and suddenly they say, you know, I have a son who would like to come to England, or whatever. There is a famous article about this by John Hitchcock, who worked among the Magars, and he was one of the first anthropologists. And he said that his solution, which he really felt morally ashamed of, but he devised the approach surrounding the word maybe. In other words, someone would say, can you take my son to England? And you would say, maybe. And that meant it was rather like in English, you have this very important, and the important parts of understanding English is the way the English say no. The English don't say no, they say yes, but. Yes, I will take your son to England, but I think we should think about it more clearly when he's a little bit older. That means no, probably. So you can, the demands on you. There were times, I suppose, when everyone was coming and saying, you're obviously very rich, and could you give us this, and could you give us that? And another, just the last point, everything of yourself and your culture and your growing up is challenged. At the deepest level, for example, your body distances and physical relations. And this can be very threatening. You saw this 2 days ago in Pokhara. One of the real problems that the couple I mentioned who brought their children back here, they had taught them the American way, which is that as growing children, no one touches you without your consent, especially an older male or something like this. But in Nepal, if you meet some a child in the street and you like the look of them, you may go, ah, you're very nice, like this. And they find this, they kick them and scream when this happened. So physical distances, and I found this with privacy. In England, you shut your door, and then no one disturbs you. I found, my wife found, really difficult the first 6 months, because you can never shut your door. You know, you're wanting to do something, and then someone bangs on the door, you have to open it. And if it's open, people just walk in, sit down, and pick up whatever, your book or whatever, and start reading it, or if you've got a bit of food there, they pick it up and start eating it. Well, you know, in England, this would be horrendous. So, the sort of individualistic surroundings of your personality are constantly threatened in field work. You have no private life. Everything is being commented on, laughed at, and so on. And that is a difficulty in integration. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your active participation and your great questions. We are very thankful to Professor Matt Farland for his wonderful talk. In order to express our gratitude, we have a small token of appreciation from the organizers. I would like to present this to you. Any further questions? We could go outside and have a talk during the tea sessions.
There's one last question from someone who I was talking to earlier. If it can be very quick. Have you got a microphone?
Can I add something to what has been said until now? Can you hear me?
Wherever you are, please.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
If you could do outside, that would be
good.
No, no.
No,
please.
I am a guru, and I think I should know more about gurus. So I think I would add whatever has been said so far. To start with, the gurus are not gurus, but they are tamus. Back in the hills, we never call ourselves gurus. We call ourselves tamus. T-A-M-U, tamus. The reason we have been called Guru is because we have been converted into Hindus some 100 years ago. And what the you can find out why we are called Guru by studying history. Someone mentioned Lami Chane. Lami Chane is a Hindu word. It is in Bahum Chetri, Tamil Namai Sarvi, and a guru, Lami Chane, is called Lem, not Lami Chane. And this business about Chal Jake and Sola Jake is the result of us being converted into Hindus. The word Chal and Sola are not guru words or tam words. They are khaskura or Nepali, as we call it now. Therefore, the gurus are when I said the gurus are not Hindu, there is a very good reason for that. The gurus marry Dharmadani uncle's daughter.
We'll have to be very quick because lots of people have got to go home.
Right.
So shall we continue this outside?
No, I'm finished. A Hindu will not marry his maternity uncle's daughter. that's a very big difference there. Thank you.
Thank you very much. For those, that wasn't a question, but those were useful, very useful comments. Now I will open my present. If I was in Japan, I wouldn't open my present because it's very rude to open a present in the presence of those. If I was in China, I would be thinking, oh no, some more tea. But in this case, it's neither tea nor anything else, but a very useful cup.
Drinking tea.
With lecture series 92. Along the column with the whole thing on it. So thank you very much.